God is going to speak a word to us today. Amen. That we can hold on just a little while longer. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, starting at verse 1. And I'm more than likely to read to verse 13. Amen. Well, y'all get there. I want to thank my worship leader for the month.
Amen.
She do a fine job. Amen. Thank you. Praise God for all the music and musicians for the month. Amen. Amen. We ended up with the men of the will. And we thank God for their offering to us today. Amen. Musically. Amen. With their musicians. Amen. And their leadership. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 through 13. If you found it, please say amen.
Amen.
And the scripture says, moreover, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And did all eat the same spiritual meat. And did all drink the same spiritual drink. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them, God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. Neither be ye idolaters as were some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication as some of them committed and fell in one day 23,000. Neither let us tempt Christ as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of the serpents. Neither murmuring ye as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. Now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world come. Wherefore let him that think that he standeth take heed lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that ye be able to bear it. Amen. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word, sanctified in our hearts, in our minds, and in our souls. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for you right now and everything that you do. Thank you, God, that you are moving even yet in this place. Thank you, God, for preaching time. Now, God, we pray for the type of anointing that's going to make preaching easy. Now, God, we pray for the type of anointing that's going to make hearing your word real easy. And, God, we pray for the type of anointing that's going to make doing your word, oh God, so very, very easy. Thank you, God, for what you're going to do in this place. Thank you, God, for how you're going to deliver in this place, how you're going to heal and save even in this place. In the name of Jesus, cover us with your blood, the precious blood of Jesus, that the devil might know whose we are and who not to mess with. In Jesus' name we do pray. And let the church say, amen.
Amen.
Today, for our time together in the Word of God, amen, I want to bring to a conclusion this series of messages that we have tagged Miracles in Your Wilderness, amen, with this sermon offering titled Destined to Come Out, amen. Let me say that one more time. Destined to Come Out. For the past few Sundays, we have taken a look through the Word of God at the children of Israel as they journeyed into the wilderness. While this is a place of trial, tribulation, and attack, the wilderness is a place of desolation and isolation. But this is where God did lead them. Now, I know from the outside looking in, it looks like that God should have taken them another way, a way that would have been easier in so many regards. But still, God chose to lead them through this wilderness. Because by the leading of the Spirit of God, the wilderness, amen, no matter what it looks like to everybody else, no matter what, even what it feels like to you, it becomes a place of preparation, amen, for what the Lord wants for and from you. Come on, somebody better understand that God has a design for your life, amen. His design may not be your design, but guess what? In the end, you're going to like what you see, amen. I want you to know it today, amen. Church, can I tell you, God loves and he believes in preparation. God reveals, God instructs, God forewarns with the idea that we all need to be also ready, amen. God knew coming out of Egypt, there were some things that the children of Israel were not ready to face, some battles they were not ready to fight. Can I tell you, God's law had to be given, faith had to be built up, attitudes needed to be changed, their resolve had to be strengthened, their relationship with God needed to be stronger, and there were lessons that they had needed to learn, amen, before they could even claim the promise that the Lord had for them. See, God had a land over beyond the peace for sure for them, amen, called the promised land, but in order for them to be ready to go in and to possess what the Lord had in store for them, they had to get ready. Come on, somebody say, get ready with me. Come on. Today, I truly believe that many of us are facing some sort of wilderness experience in our lives. And it may not be a physical desert as the children of Israel faced, but it's still a wilderness nonetheless. The wilderness can be uncomfortable. It is a place where attacks occur, a place where your back is up against the wall, a place where it seems like you are trapped between the proverbial rock and the hard place. Come on. But the wilderness is a place, amen, amen, where some sickness that you have in your body won't get well, where doctors' reports that don't offer hope, that loved ones that are going through and you feel like you're powerless to help them. The wilderness can be a place of darkness and disarray, dysfunction and destruction. The wilderness can be a place of lack and not nearly enough. But the wilderness can be all that and more. But that doesn't have to be all it is. Well, the wilderness is designed by the enemy to be unbearable. But with the leading of God, the wilderness is ultimately beautiful. Come on. In the wilderness, amen, the enemy wants to see you torn down, but God wants to lift you up. In the wilderness, well, the enemy wants to destroy you, God's plan is to deliver you. In the wilderness, well, the enemy continues to show contempt for you, God shows his compassion for you. In the wilderness where the enemy despises you, God said, my delight is in you. Come on, anybody want God's delight to be in them? Well, sometimes you get the good things from God. You got to go through some tough times. Come on, that's the wilderness. Church, you may be in the wilderness. But I want to tell you today that you can get through this. It is the design of God, the plan of God, the will of God, your destiny in God to come on out. Come on. Somebody, you got to get out of there. Amen. And see, God is getting ready for you to grab hold to all the promises that he has for you. God did not lead you into the wilderness. Amen. He will not lead you into the wilderness until he has already begun something in you. Come on. See, some of us have been clamoring and praying to God to begin in me, to birth in me, to start in me. You better watch out what you're asking for. Because can I tell you, when God began to birth some things, how many of y'all women know that the baby at the end gonna be sweet, but it's trouble getting that thing out of you? Come on. You got to understand. It's some trouble getting that thing out of you. Sometimes God puts something inside of you that's grown, God. God has put something inside of you that's growing, and it's about to be big, and about to be great, and about to be fantastic in the Lord, and the kingdom of the Lord shall be blessed. And you say to yourself, how is that thing going to come out? Well, God said, I know. First, I'll take you through some wilderness. Come on. You got to understand that even in the midst of the wilderness, God is getting ready, amen, to make the move. God is getting ready to make his move. God is getting ready to make his stand in his anointing move in the glory. glory. Speak His truth, testify of His goodness, and live according to the word. Even in the midst of the wilderness, too many times we didn't want to go in the wilderness. Oh, I gotta come off script right now. Too many times we didn't want to go into the wilderness. But can I tell you, if the wilderness is where the Lord has led you, well, then this is where you need to go. Because if the wilderness and God has put you there, for whatever reason. Oh, God, if you look at our text today, I know I won't be able to preach everything, but I'm going to preach enough. If you look at our text today, Paul is beginning to teach, and you might wonder to yourself, all of you that have been with me through this series, you know where I've been. I've been in the book of Exodus. Where in the world did he jump all the way across here to the book of 1 Corinthians? Let me tell you, I jumped because the Lord jumped. We need to stop, amen, looking backwards and thinking, amen, we can do it just like the children of Israel did. Can I tell the truth about the children of Israel? See, God had them in the wilderness for a reason, but they twisted God's word, and they twisted God's reasoning, and they began to murmur and complain, and to fuss and to fight with nearly every miracle that they got. Nearly everyone, it was born out of a frustration with God. Nearly every miracle, it was born out of a lack of faith in God. See, we can't just feed into that, but we got to come into a brand new dispensation. Can I tell you something right now? See, the brand new dispensation says this, that it's time out for being a baby, that it's time out that when you hear the word, you need to grow up, that when you hear the word, you need to keep the word, that when you hear the word, you need to get the word, when you hear the word, you need to use the word. And the word of God said that I would not have you ignorant. Amen. What Israel went through, it was born out of a frustration with God. I don't want God to bless me because I whined about it. I want God to bless me because I stood on His word. I don't want God to bless me. I want God, I want to be just wondering, you know, that I get blessed because I came enough, I hung around enough, I got some of what somebody else really pressed, really owed God. I'm getting in trouble, but I don't care. He said, look, if you look down in verse 2, he said, they all were baptized. He said, they were all baptized under Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And then they all eat the same spirit when we watch this. And God said, I'm going to bring you out. And God said, you're destined to come. And God said, you can't come up. Everybody didn't want to go. But when the number moved, the rest of them said, I'm too lazy to do anything else. So I'll move too. So the number moved. And when the glory came, the glory came, the glory came. We talked about the glory in every one of these sermons. We talked about the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. How it represented the Shekinah of God, the glory of God. And that's what God did. God let it rain on the just and the unjust. Even though them that did not want to be there, would not do right, would not act right, God still allowed them to be under the cover of the glory. God took them from Egypt, brought them out with the riches of Egypt, and He took them on His journey. He led them hard by the Red Sea, mounted on either side of the Red Sea in front of them, and the army of Pharaoh behind them. Everybody was under the cloud, everybody was baptized, but guess what? Everybody did not rejoice in God before the miracle. That there was some that murmured and said, Moses, why did you bring us here? But guess what? According to the word, they sealed the end. They sealed the blessed. He said they ate the same spiritual meat. Watch this. They ate because they murmured and complained. See, they didn't come to Moses to get a word from the Lord. They came to Moses with this word. You should have left us in Egypt. You would have lived by the flesh pot in bondage and ate good every day. But you lead me out here to this wilderness and now I'm going to die. Look, so God fed them. He fed them with a miracle. He fed them from heaven. He fed them with quail. But guess what? That miracle didn't come just because they loved the Lord and were about His business. It came because they murmured and complained. That's the Watch this. You got to be careful. I know I'm preaching it kind of tough right now, but you got to be careful, y'all. What you murmur and complain about, what you always find fault in, what you always find occasion to raise up your voice in a negative manner. It ain't got to do against me, but it can be. It ain't got to do against your deacon, but it can be. It can be against your child. It can be against your loved one. If they're moving in the spirit of the living God, you got to be careful how you raise your voice up. But look, let me tell you something. While they were busy raising their voices and they were marching along with everybody else because they weren't destined to come out, their destiny was being overtaken by the enemy in the wilderness. Come on. Some of y'all right now, under the sound of my voice, are falling for the tricks of the enemy. When you won't raise your hand, when you won't open your mouth, when you won't give God the glory, oh, look, let me go back further. When you don't treat your neighbor right, when you don't love everybody around, let me go back further. When you don't read your Bible, when you don't pray, let me go back further. When you won't witness, when you won't love, when you won't give, oh, let me go back further. When you won't be obedient to the word of God, you are letting the enemy step into your destiny. Come on. Come on, somebody. They were beginning to let the enemy step into their destiny. Amen. But the Bible said, look, this is how I know. See, Paul is telling it 1,500 years. It's almost 1,800 years later. Paul is telling it. He said, but many of them, even though they ate, they drank, look, they even had a glimpse of Jesus. Oh, God. Some of us have said, well, you know, if the Lord wouldn't know, he'd tell me himself. Well, you know what? That foul spirit of stiffness that was in the children of Israel, Jesus did come. Yes. Oh, y'all said, what? Y'all remember last week? What did y'all tell y'all last week? When they brought the rock for Moses to stand on. Who did the rock? They brought the Jesus. Look at your text. Look at your text. Y'all thought your time to make it up with it. Y'all thought that was a good standing hoop last week when I said the rock is Jesus. It wasn't a good standing hoop. It was the word of God. That rock is Jesus. The rock. The rock that Moses sat in was Jesus. The rock that the water spewed out of was Jesus. The rock that followed, there was a rock that followed them in the spirit to lead them, bring them water in the midst of the desert. That rock was Jesus. And they still saw Jesus and still decided to let the enemy in. Come on, you got to understand, you can't let the enemy in. The enemy cannot contaminate your destiny unless you live. Come on. Somebody, you better realize today you are destined. You are destined. Say it with me. You are destined to come out. You are destined to come out. Watch this, y'all. Look, it was so many of them. Amen. So many of them did not please God. They fell. They fell by the wayside. They fell because of their murmuring. They fell because of their idol worship. They fell. They fell. They ate with the enemy. They drunk with the enemy. And they partied with the enemy. When their words say they rose up to play, they played like the idol worship was played. And can I tell you, the idol worship don't play fair. I know I'm in a PG church, but I'm going to make it cheap for you. Amen. Because I don't want to offend nobody. But when they played with their morality. Amen. That's what I'm saying. They weren't playing spades, big wits. Amen. They were playing with immorality. And God was looking upon them and said, how dare you when I have preached to you, when I have performed miracles for you, when I have given you from the bottom of my heart, how dare you turn with the enemy? Not only did they turn with the enemy, but they murmured and complained about the people of God. They did all of this. And look, and they expected more miracles, oh God. Can I tell you right now, too many of y'all waiting around, I'm going to say it, getting mad at you like that. Too many of us, me included, waiting around what God going to do next. With God that already did enough, with God that already been enough, with God already is enough, that we ought to be satisfied. But look, and then we begin to miss the whole point. Can I tell you, the miracles in the wilderness wasn't about what you could get from God. The miracles in the wilderness ain't about what God will do for you. The miracles in the wilderness is about building your faith so you can believe God for the greater. Come on, you have to get this now. It was no good. It gave God no glory for the children of Israel to get all these things in the wilderness. Oh, the manna from heaven was great. The prayer from heaven was great. The parting of the Red Sea was great. The defeating of Amalek was great. The defeating of the giant tribes. They were great. They were great. They were great. But God is only judged by one thing, and that is the victory of your destiny. Come on. God is only judged by one thing. Can I tell you, the devil is sitting by. You know his name is the accuser of the brother. And the devil would do you like he did Job. He'll go to God on your behalf, and he will say he wouldn't serve you if he had a little trouble. He would go to God and accuse you of everything. And God can only stand on his word and what you do. But there is a responsibility for you and me. God doesn't give you miracles. God doesn't give you deliverance just to see you happy. But God gives it to you so you can build your faith. And when he builds your faith, he that has done a good work in you will keep on working. See, God's work depends on your faith. Jesus said, I can do no great miracles because of their unbelief. How many of y'all know that you are the pride of the Lord's eye? You are the apple of his eye, his crowning achievement. He wants to do in you what no other power can do, that Holy Ghost power. But you will stop the Lord. You will block the Lord. You will stay off your destiny's path because of your unbelief. Your faith must be in the Lord. And your faith is not in God. Then what can God do for you? And it is the enemy's job then to go to God and make a mockery of your life. Why, oh Lord, why did you create them? Why, oh Lord, why did you make them? Why, oh Lord, why did you give them a gift? Did you give them a talent? They use you, oh Lord. How do you think that makes God feel? How do you think that makes God? How would you feel if I told you I never loved you? I just used for what you could do for me. And then when it came time, I turned my back on you faster than fast, quicker than quick. How would you feel? Well, the same way the Lord feels when you turn back on him. He knows where your destiny lies because he created your destiny. He knew your end from your beginning. Before you was a twinkle in your daddy's eye, God knew you. Before you was a cosmic thought, God already had a plan for you. And God's will was for you to come out. Come on, somebody. You better give God a praise right there. Because see, look. What that means for you, no matter what the devil put on you, God's will is for you to come out. Amen. What that means for you, and no matter how you may have failed, God's will is still for you to come out.
Amen. Watch this, y'all.
The Bible lets me know that the wilderness is also a place,
amen,
of two things.
Amen.
Oh, can I tell you? In the wilderness, you're getting prepared, but it's also a place of temptation. And in the midst of the temptation, it is the devil's job to stop you from reaching,
amen,
what God has for you.
Amen.
Oh, but I cannot tell you this. You are destined to come out. No matter what is going on with you, you are destined to come out.
Yes,
no matter what you're going through, you are destined to come out. No matter how many times you fail, you are destined to come out. Moses failed for 40 years on the backside of the desert, but he was destined to come out. David fell in the arms of Bathsheba, and he hid from the Lord for a whole year, but he was destined to come out. Solomon never lost his mind, but all the riches and the concubines, but he was destined to come out. Esther didn't know where she came from no more. She got up in the palace and she forgot all about her people, but she remembered that she was created for such a time as this. Why? Because she was destined to come out. The Bible lets me know in our text, it says in our text, this is a word of warning. This is a word of encouragement. This is a word of admonition to you, because what had happened to the children of Israel, it could happen to you. Can I tell tell you, many of them fell by the wayside, and so many of them did not make it. God saved a few and brought them to the promised land. But can I tell you today, my job is your pastor is to make sure every last one of you make it. I want you to make it because you are destined to come out. But watch this. The Bible said a word of warning. Look at verse 12. It said, wherefore let him that thinketh he that he standeth take heed lest he fall. Look, I want you to understand. The word goes on to say, there is no temptation even in your wilderness. Yeah, but that's just common to man. Can I tell you, first thing I'll tell you right quick, that you won't fall because you ain't never seen it before. Can I tell you, the devil ain't got no brand new tricks. He ain't got nothing new under the sun. He's bringing the same thing. He's bringing the same old lust of the eyes of pride of life. He's bringing it all back to you. He's showing it to you. He's giving it to you. And sometimes it's in a brand new package, but it's the same old thing. Amen. You got to understand that you can make it because God said you can make it. Then the next thing I'll tell you, God is faithful. Amen. He will not leave you never alone. You can make it. If God brought you into the wilderness, it is his job to get you out of the wilderness. If you believe it, say amen. God is faithful. He's faithful not just to the end, but he's faithful even beyond the end. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. And then he said that I will not allow you to be tested above what you can stand. What that means is that as you have applied yourself, as you have given yourself to God, as you've given yourself to prayer, as you've given yourself to fasting, as you've given yourself to the love of God, as you have prepared even in the wilderness, that God will let the enemy come at you, but he'll have to leave seven ways. He'll come at you one way, but he'll flee seven ways. The Bible says, trust not in the chariot, some trust in horses, but I will depend on the word, on the strength of the Lord my God. He will not allow you to be tested and tempted above or what you are able. But he said in his word that for every temptation, I'll make a way. I'll make a way out of no way. I'll make a way for you to come out. I'll make a way for you to stand up. I'll make a way for you to be strong. I'll make a way for you to be counted. I'll make a way for you to move. I'll make a way for you to go. You won't have to stand by yourself. But if you stand on my word, I'll make a way. All you gotta do is hold on. Check a little while longer. You gotta know the take. And the Lord will make a way for you to escape so that you'll be able. That you'll be able to stand it. Can I tell you? I know that that seems like a whole lot of fine words. And the Lord has done all of that. And I know my destiny to come out. It sounds good, but you might need just a little bit more. Do you know that in the Word of God, we have an anchor, and we need to make sure our anchor holds and it grips the solid rock, and that rock is Jesus. But can I tell you a little bit more about it? You come to church every week, so you get to hear something about Jesus all the time. But I want to tell you something that maybe you did not realize. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 and 15, inasmuch then as we have such a great high priest who had already ascended and passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession of faith in him. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to understand and who is unable to sympathize with us. And we have shared feelings. He has a shared feeling for our weakness. He has a shared feeling for our infirmities. He has a shared feeling of the liability and what it costs to be assaulted by temptation. But he is one who has been tempted in every respect, just like you and me. Yet he knew sin not. Can I tell you what that means? That means that Jesus had to go through a wilderness too. Some of y'all think that Jesus didn't have to go through like you went through. And I know some of y'all God was tired of the same whatever. He was tempted, but only for 40 days. He only was tempted for 40 days. I've been being tempted all my life. Can I make the record real straight for you? Jesus was in a wilderness for more than 33 years. And I can tell to you that every day he spent on this side of God's heavens, and he was in a wilderness. Come on, you got to understand, Jesus went through just like you went through. You got to think about it. Jesus was in heaven, sitting by the throne of God, and the Spirit led him in to leave the heavens and go down to a sinful world. That sound like wilderness to me. He did not come in the world as the King of Kings. He did not come into the world as the Lord of Lords. But he came as a baby wrapped his swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. And even though he was royalty, he was born under a poor parents in a stable outside of an inn in Bethlehem. Come on, somebody. That sound like wilderness to me. See, for Jesus, heaven was nothing like this. Come on. See, earth was the breeding ground for sin. Earth was in a disarray. Earth was not anything that Jesus was used to. But can I tell you, he came to the wilderness just for me and you. See, me and you need to know that we can be in the wilderness, but the wilderness don't have to be in you. Come on. Because the wilderness not a bad inside of him. Jesus was flesh. He was blood. He felt tired. He felt hurt. He was physically and emotionally drained. He hungered. He thirsted. Oh, this sounds like the wilderness to me, dog. He was still Jesus. Yes, he had power, but he was still in the wilderness. Yes, he was able to perform miracles. He healed the sick. He raised the dead. 5,000 hungry souls. He mounted to many, all on different levels. But can I tell you, he was still, he was still in the wilderness. While Jesus had the power and the backing of God, he still saw his people being oppressed and mistreated by the Romans, mistreated and oppressed by their own leaders. He saw his family members die. He was misunderstood by his family. He was left behind by his family. He was left out by his family. He was talked about by his family. Jesus was the one. He was still in a wilderness. Did that sound familiar to anybody? I know I've been through some of that, y'all. See, he was in the wilderness that Jesus' enemies plotted against him. False witness on him, had him arrested, violated his civil rights, stripped him, beat him, then beat him some more. All because he was still yet in the wilderness. Some of y'all recognize that, but that's not all. You got to go through, you all go through some of that. But can I tell you, Jesus began to take it to another level. You see, not only did they have it, amen, but they wanted to kill him. They had Jesus. Jesus was to the point that he knew in his spiritual mind from being close to the Lord that he was coming near the end of the wilderness. And because of the fact that coming through the end of the wilderness meant he had to get ready to go through something he had never been through before. So he went down to the Garden of Gethsemane. Anybody got a Garden of Gethsemane in the wilderness? Sometimes you need a Garden of Gethsemane in the wilderness so you can get your mind right, get your heart right, get your soul right, so you can go on through for God, so you can fulfill your destiny. Jesus went on down to the Garden of Gethsemane and he got his mind right, so he can suffer through his destiny. He said, oh, Lord, 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 if it be thy will, let this come back for me. But see, that wasn't in his destiny, so the Lord ain't after. Some of y'all wondering why the Lord ain't talking to you about certain things, because that ain't part of your destiny. If any part of your destiny, you don't need me saying that. You better go home in the name of the Lord. Come on. But look, Lord, you said that Jesus knew the deal. But Jesus got up and he let the soldiers take him. He let them take him from judgment hall to judgment hall. He let them do all the things that they had to do to him. Why? Because he was in the wilderness. But it was his destiny to come out. They took him to put a crown of thorns on his head. They whipped his back until the flesh fell from his bones. But he did it because even though he was in the wilderness, it was still his destiny to come out. You can't come out of the wilderness by going backwards. Amen. You got to push on. Oh, you got to watch. You got to go on with Christian soldier marching past the war with the cross of Jesus going on. You need to march to the cross, to the mountain. Even though he was on the big double road, he was still on the wilderness trail. He was marching with his head bowed down in sorrow, eyes full of tears, but he was marching in the wilderness. He marched all the way from the wilderness to the cross of Calvary. He got up on the cross with nails in his hand and nails in his feet, with his head in the lock of his shoulder, and gave up the ghost. We were still in the wilderness. But you know what he did? He did one thing. He said, my spirit that is full of my destiny. Oh Lord, I commit my spirit unto you. And he gave up the ghost. Sometimes to come out of the wilderness, you got to give up everything. Some of us wonder why we've been in the wilderness so long. It's because we still got holding on to the wrong thing. Yeah. Jesus gave up the ghost. He gave up anything.
Yes, sir.
But you know what he traded off for giving up the ghost? He tell me that the old Baptist preacher said. Then he hung his head and then he died. And he took him down and put him in a fire tomb. And somebody said that it was Friday night. He laid there all Friday night. But they tell me that it was Saturday night. And he was still laying there. And then they tell me around Saturday night, the devil threw a party. There was anger, pride. He said, I done contaminated his destiny. I got him now. He's in the grave. But little did he know that I got you right where I want you. And you see, when the devil think it's all over, God and the Father bring you up. And tell me on the Thursday morning that Jesus got up with all power in his hands. That he got up not only with power, but he got up in destiny. Not only with your destiny, but he got up with your destiny too. Very destiny is wrapped up, tied up, tangled up in Jesus. Aren't you glad that the rock found you all the way through the wilderness? Aren't you glad that the rock saved you all the way through the wilderness? Aren't you glad that the rock gave you water all the way through the wilderness? The rock knew that he can't win unless you win. And if you win, he win. And at the end of the day, when he got up with all power in his hand, he put a landmark on the ground that you can follow. So when you win the wilderness and you can't see your way out, you look up for the cross. 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 And at the cross, where I first saw the light and the prayer through my heart rolled away. I received my sight. It was there by faith. I began to march off the wilderness. It was there by faith. I began to overcome the wilderness. It was there by faith. I got my destiny. It was there by faith. I got my deliverance. It was there by faith. I received my sight. And now I'm having all the day. Come on. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. The wilderness. You will see miracles. You will see the greatest miracle. And give God his glory when you come out.